evening, everyone. Thank you very much for coming this evening, and welcome to the Dworkin and Bernstein Management Lecture Series at Lakeland Community College. I really do appreciate you coming out this evening, and I think if our dinner discussion was anything, you are going to love tonight's talk. I really do think you're going to enjoy it. So I want to introduce our speaker tonight, and his name is Bill Sanford. Bill Sanford is the founder and chairman of Symark LLC, which is a technology commercialization and business development organization. You might better recognize his other endeavor while he's owned this and then some years ago as the executive founder and retired chairman of the board, president, and chief executive officer of Steris Corporation. You may know Steris Corporation as a global leader in infection and contamination prevention and surgical and critical care technologies. Mr. Sanford started with Steris when it had a staff of 5 people and helped it grow to the powerhouse today, which is over 5,000 people working there. And he'll talk a lot about that. His business career has been focused on the development and commercialization of biosciences products and services, clinical information systems, nanotechnology, and other technology-based innovations. He has several patents related to advanced technology and medical devices. If you remember from your marketing class when you heard about the product life cycle, Mr. Sanford is an active investor in companies in the introduction and growth stages of the product life cycle. He does that through Symark, and he also serves as a board member on many companies' boards for both public and private organizations and for-profit and not-for-profit organizations. Mr. Sanford attended Kansas State University and graduated with a degree in zoology. He lives in Florida with his wife, Gwen, and they have 5 children. So would you please join me in welcoming Bill Sanford, founder and chairman of Symark LLC.
Thank you, Professor Barnes, for that nice introduction. The most important thing she said was Kansas State University. The Wildcats are ranked number 4 this week in the BCS. So let's hear it for Kansas State University. I happen to still be a season ticket holder there, and my wife Gwen and I have been out there for a couple of games this year, and we'll be back for more. So it really is fun. We're also big supporters of that other small school down in Columbus, Ohio State. And while they keep winning, it's a miracle how they do it. But it's a lot of fun. But again, thank you very much, Christine, for that nice introduction. I was fortunate to have dinner with my wife, Gwen, and some long time ago colleagues, Morris Beveridge and Gary Eith. For several years, I served on the board of Lakeland Community College, and it's one of the more rewarding things that I've ever done. My wife is also a graduate of Lakeland Community College, so we have some ties. But I think, as I said, the most important thing was Kansas State. Even more important, our 2.5-year-old granddaughter is a student in the day school, or whatever you call it, here at Lakeland Community College. So we have a lot of connections to this wonderful institution. Bob Kane was also at dinner tonight, and I've had a lot of interaction with Bob in his role heading the foundation, doing great work to raise funds for scholarships and other important things that happen here at Lakeland. Also just saw my good friend Jim Collins, who's been involved with Lakeland for a long time with his TV shows and other sorts of things that he, I guess you don't call them TV shows, but whatever they are. Yeah, they are TV shows. Doing a great job interviewing politicians and other somewhat worthwhile things. Not always, but somewhat. Tonight, I'm going to, when asked to do something like this, you're almost obligated to brag, and I don't like to do that, but tonight I'm going to brag unabashedly about some things that have happened. So I'll talk a bit about my personal background, some business experiences. The company Steris was mentioned. I was so excited to go to the bathroom tonight and see all that Steris hand stuff in the restrooms. And so I took a couple extra squirts so they can make more money. I also think that it's very important for all of us, whether we're students or whether we are in the retirement years, to attempt to, as some people say, give back to the community. I call it do-gooder work, and I'll talk a bit about that. And I might even have a couple of political comments because it's that time of year, as I think we're tired of seeing ads on television. And then we'll have a Q&A session. When I talk about my youth, I'm one of those kids that walked barefoot in the snow to school uphill both ways. And so what I'm about to tell you is actually true. I was born on in a farmhouse, my grandparents' farmhouse in southeastern Missouri. My grandpa was a cotton farmer. He had 120 acres, which is not a lot of cotton. We had no running water. We did have electricity. We had no telephone. But it was really a great place to have been born to my, at the time, 18-year-old parents. My mom and dad had met when he was on leave from the Navy in World War II, and they got married, and little Billy came along a short time thereafter. But spent my early years in Gibson, Missouri, in a two-room school. We had the first through the fifth grade in one room, and the sixth through the eighth grade in the other room. My favorite memory is that on the first day of school, the teacher in the first grade, we didn't have kindergarten, the teacher said, the first kid who can learn to count to 100 gets a dime, okay? And that was to be a big challenge. And I held up my hand to count to 100. It's because my mother had, my wonderful mother, had taught me as a kid at the kitchen table how to do math and how to read and how to count and all those sorts of things. So in any case, spent the first few years there. Even the schoolhouse didn't have any indoor plumbing. We had to go outside. But the best thing that happened in school was to be assigned pump duty, because you got out of class 5 minutes before recess so you could go outside and prime the pump so people could get a drink of water. So after a time there, we moved to the big metropolis of Stafford, Kansas, which is where my dad was from. Small town, wonderful place, and I went through my early years there, and then we moved to another little town in Kansas, Ellenwood, Kansas, which is where I went through junior high and high school. Great place, played every sport that they had, musician stuff, wonderful education. And we were so poor, we didn't know it because everybody else was too. I mean, it was just a terrific environment for growing up. Had the good fortune to win an athletic scholarship to Kansas State University, and went through school in 4 years with no summer school, and earned a degree in biological sciences with a focus on zoology. My objective had been to be a coach and a teacher. And I actually had an offer to be an assistant coach at a little college, Sterling College in Sterling, Kansas, a Division III school. But my last semester in college, my mother and I, on my spring break, went back to Missouri to visit her parents, my grandparents, in the farmhouse where I was born. It now has running water and even a telephone. But in any case, I was reading the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, one ads, and there was a one ad in there for a company called American Hospital Supply Corporation. Fabulous, fabulous company. And my mom had talked about a sales rep when she worked in this little hospital in Stafford, Kansas. She would come home periodically and talk about this great sales rep from American Hospital Supply. And so I recognized the name and wrote a letter, just a lark about myself, and a couple days later, I got a letter back. I went for interviews, and the proverbial long story short, was offered a job for American Hospital Supply. And it really put a damper on my thought process relative to coaching, because I was going to get $350 a month to be the assistant coach. And I had this offer from American Hospital Supply for $525 a month. Man, easy decision. I had no money, so go where the money was. And it's the luckiest thing that ever happened to me. And the point of that is that one can take advantage of opportunities at any point in time, but you have to take action. I could just as easily read that one ad and said, oh, I remember that name, and it'd be nice to think about doing something, but not doing it. And my life would have been completely different. So in any case, I was hired, went through a sales training program, and I was absolutely intimidated, because I was little Billy Sanford from Ellenwood, Kansas, with a degree in zoology from Kansas State University. And the people in the sales training class were from the Big Ten schools and Harvard and Yale, and many of them had their MBAs. And I said, what in the world am I doing here? But the one thing that I had learned of many things in the small town was how to outwork anyone else. And so I did just that, and did well in the sales training program, went out, did well as a sales representative, driving 50,000 miles, a literal real number, 50,000 miles a year to my little hospital customers out in western Kansas. Got a promotion to a big territory in Denver, Colorado, but then got on the corporate management ladder and went through a whole series of sales management, general management jobs as a corporate vagabond. I mean, I was one of those that the phone would ring from my boss and say, hey, Bill, we've got a job for you in wherever. And I'd say, where's the moving van? And away we'd go. So all of those moves led to my being named the youngest vice president ever in the history of the company. And when I was 29 years old, I was running a $100 million business in New York. And two interesting things there. That was a lot of money even then. But here's this little Kansas kid in New York doing something that was pretty worthwhile. After doing that for several years, I was recruited away and got, I was always fascinated by health services. And so I got in the health services business, primarily with clinical laboratory services, and ran a couple of very large clinical laboratories. And in the late 70s, we sold the business that has now migrated to becoming Quest and LabCorp. You've heard of those companies, perhaps. But that was the start of the whole clinical laboratory industry growth. And at that point in time, one of the stops on my vagabond tour had been Columbus, Ohio. And I had fallen in love with Columbus, Ohio. And I used to not so jokingly say, it's the kind of city that doesn't get many A's in anything. It gets a lot of B's, but it gets very few C's, D's, or F's. It was truly middle America. You've got Appalachian, you've got a big university town, the government headquarters for the state of Ohio. I mean, really, really nice things. And so I was living in Portland, Oregon, and moved cold turkey to Columbus, Ohio, with no business, no contacts, no anything. And that's where I was going to probably die someday. Maybe sooner than I thought, and thinking back about that. So in any case, moved to Columbus and started the company that is Symark. It had a different name then. It had Health Development Incorporated. But started Symark, whose role in life was to help hospitals primarily commercialize services like lab services and other sorts of things, but also to expand and do development of innovative sorts of medical related stuff. And we were so far ahead of our time, thinking back about it. We were doing expert systems, information technology expert systems on Apple IIs and the first IBM PC. This little company was the second ever IBM personal computer value added distributor. Those things that we were doing were phenomenal, but they were opportunistic on one hand, but they were also very well planned on another. But the point there is that opportunism is important. One of the things that I recall is that one day I was watching the Today Show, and there was a woman on there from Syracuse University, Dr. Sarah Short, and she was recognized as one of the premier sports nutritionists in the world. And she was talking about this giant, or this computerized nutrition program that she was running on very large computers at that point in time, and it impressed me. So I called her up and met with her, and we decided that perhaps we could do that on personal computers, and we did. So we developed what became the most prominent computerized nutrition and diet analysis program that existed at that time. Today, you know, it's second nature. But again, we were doing things that were way, way ahead of our time. So in my work in Columbus in developing things, I had developed a relationship with a young venture capitalist in Cleveland named Loyal Wilson. A group called Primus Venture Partners, which now is Primus Capital Partners, had been formed by an organization that was then called Cleveland Tomorrow, which was made up of the CEOs of the 50 largest companies in Cleveland. And this was in the mid-80s, and there were a lot of big companies in Cleveland with corporate headquarters here at that point in time. But that organization, Cleveland Tomorrow, had recognized that Cleveland needed an economic boost, and that one of the real attributes of Cleveland was the whole bio community, the hospitals and other sorts of things. However, there was very little commercialization going on at the time. So they formed Primus Venture Partners, initially with a $15 million investment that became $30 million shortly thereafter, and recruited a guy from First Chicago, Loyal Wilson, a young guy, to come and head that effort. But Loyal and I had become acquainted, and I had tried to get him to invest in some of my deals in Columbus, and he never would do it. He was too smart to do that. And so, but he called me one day and said, hey, Bill, will you do me a favor? And I said, sure, I'll do you a favor. And he says, there's this company up here, a very smart scientist named Ray Kralovic, who was in a big company, and he has some ideas on a new way that might be good for disinfecting or sterilizing heat-sensitive devices. And we're not sure whether we should invest in that, so would you take a look at it and tell me what we should do? And so we looked at it, looked at the market opportunity and the technology, and a few weeks later we're talking to Loyal and said, you know, this thing actually looks like it could be good. Right now there's not much of a market for what is being proposed, but there is going to be one because of some changes that are going on in healthcare. The science and technology looks like it may work, and there's been some proof of concept with some studies that were done at Case, and so it might make sense. And so Loyal did one of these things. He said, hey, if you'll run that, I'll finance it. And I said, no, we've got other things to do. But we talked about it for a while, and it was really it was a crazy idea. It was a far-thinking idea. But we decided, well, let's make a go of it. And so on April 1st, 1987, purposely April 1st, because only a fool would be doing that, right? So on April 1st, Steris was formed out of what had been a little company called Innovative Medical Technologies that Ray Kralovic had. We said we can't use that name because it wouldn't fit on a business card. So we chose the name Steris again, which is, if you're interested, an acronym for Sterile Immersion System. Steris, S-T-E-R-I-S. It also has six letters. It's symmetrical. It starts with an S, ends in an S. Psychologists say we can only remember six things at a time, so that's why it has six letters. So there, you marketers, there are some things that you really need to think about when you're doing whatever it is you're trying to do. Don't just take the first impulse. Think through what you're doing. So in any case, we formed Steris, April Fool's Day, 1987. $1.2 million investment that had a post-money valuation of $3 million. Now, I'm going to run through some numbers, and I'm doing it purposely just to make a point of what can be made to happen anywhere, even in Mentor, Ohio, okay? So 1987, $3 million valuation. We go through 3 years of product development. There were a lot of things that went wrong. Maybe in the question and answer session, I can tell you some really kind of humorous stories. But in any case, we raised another $10.3 million over a four-year period of time. That money was raised on a year-by-year basis. We really had pressure on ourselves in that sense. We would raise some money and would make a commitment to accomplish a certain set of things in a one-year period of time. If we did, we went back to the well, we brought in another venture capitalist, a new one, who would price the deal, and then the current venture people would step up with their pro rata share of whatever the next investment was. But it was a very high-risk process. We didn't have millions and millions of dollars like some of the biotech companies and the IT companies have. It was tough. But we made it through the FDA, the product development, the FDA validation, and all of these sorts of things. And we had created, our business model was a classic razor blade model, in the sense that we were going to be selling tabletop machines to do something, which I won't talk about because of time, but we wanted to have a consumable component. So every time devices were processed in this machine, they'd hit the start button and it was $5, $5, $5. And that was very important from a recurring revenue standpoint. And our economic model would be that 50% of our revenues would come from captive recurring sources. And that actually proved to be very well. So in any case, we're growing. When you have outside venture investors, they want a liquidity event at some point in time. One that we had been shooting for was an initial public offering of our stock. And so we had started in late 91 putting together the program whereby we were going to go public in 1992. The first half of 92, things were going well, and all of a sudden our economy, our national economy, went in the tank. And the IPO market stopped. We were the last company, the last medical device company in 1992 to be able to go public. That was in June of 92, and we went public at half the price that we had intended. But we had to go because we'd already spent $1 million on legal and accounting fees, and if we didn't go public, we didn't have $1 million to pay our advisors. So we went ahead and went public. And at that point in time, remember, $3 million in 1987, we go public with a market valuation of $50 million. So we had gone from 3 to 50 in 5 years. We did well. 9 months later, we did a secondary offering at a valuation of $100 million. So in 6 months, we doubled the value, or 9 months rather, we doubled the value of the company. We then performed very well and became opportunistic. And in the period of 1994 through 1996, we made 8 acquisitions, including 2 New York Stock Exchange companies, including one that was the leader in the industry. And perhaps we'll talk more about that also in the Q&A because it's an interesting story. But at that point in time, our market value was $600 million. The moment we announced this big acquisition, our stock price got tanked 25% because everybody thought this fast-growing superstar company was buying this big giant company, which was a great company, but it was going to slow down the growth. And so we got hammered. However, 2 years later, our market value was $2.5 billion. So it was a very good series of acquisitions. And accusations also. Now, the reason for talking about that is as I said, it gives you an opportunity as an individual to ring the bell on the New York Stock Exchange, to do things that you had never dreamed as a little kid in Ellenwood, Kansas, could be possible. But how did we do it? And when I say we, it was an absolute collective we. It was an extraordinary time in life within the company that was growing like crazy in Mineral, Ohio. We did it because we absolutely, up front, had defined the market opportunity. We knew what the customers would want. Okay. We were not a technology company trying to sell something. We were a marketing company with a great technology. Big, big difference. The second thing that we did was to design the system that was totally different from anything ever before. It was a sterilization system, but I'm sure all of you have seen big sterilizer somewhere. This was a tabletop unit. It looked like an analytical instrument. It was beautiful, great industrial design. As I said, it had this captive razor blade that was used every time the process was run. We had invested heavily in our intellectual property, in our patents. We had a master patent that was just magnificent. But then we built a whole picket fence of other related patents so that if anybody could even try to sneak in to something around our master patent, we had a whole bunch of other stuff to protect us from a regulatory perspective. We were a group of overachievers. The people who came into the company were performing at levels they had never dreamed of. One of our objectives was to create an environment where people, in fact, would be self-motivated. They would take on responsibilities and authority. They were given the authority, and they would take on the responsibilities to perform. Our culture was just one of just doing whatever it took to accomplish the most important thing of all, and that was to take care of our customers better than anyone else could. And by our customer and by anyone else, we always considered that our competition was anyone trying to sell anything to one of our customers because they were competing for money. And so we had to be really good so that not only could we beat a directly competitive product, but we could also appeal to the people providing the funds to run the business that purchasing our system is more important than purchasing something else, a new computer or whatever it happened to be. And we did that by just this absolute zealot approach to taking care of the customer. A couple of little things. We never had an answering system on a telephone. Anytime the word customer was in print, the letter C was capitalized, even in the middle of a sentence. If a customer called, and if any of us was in a meeting, including a board meeting or whatever it happened to be, the customer could never, ever be told that we'll have to get back to you because he or she's in a meeting. We took the call. We established a customer training program whereby instead of our going out to the customers to install the new systems and teach them how to use it and all that sort of stuff, we brought them to us. Now, we did that initially because we couldn't afford to go and it was cheaper to bring them here. But that wasn't the ultimate point. In a period of about 3 or 4 years, we trained 20,000 operating nurses in Mentor, Ohio. We were the largest customer of Quail Hollow. It was remarkable. We would pick up these nurses at the airport in limos and bring them out, and many of them had never left Kentucky. Or the ones from California would say, why in the world am I going to Cleveland, Ohio in the wintertime? And they'd come that way and they'd leave loving the company. Greatest marketing thing we ever did. We had some very important goals, and I want to share these with you because I think these are goals that all of us in life can use. But again, you students, and this presentation is primarily for the students because I just am so excited about your futures. But we had, in fact, I've got in my pocket. This is my name badge. And although you can't see it, there's a much younger picture on there than now. But importantly, on the back of the name badge are the six most important things that we're focused on. And every person in the company had a name badge with these six on the back. And the first is the importance of the customer. The customer is the most important person in our business life to be treated with the utmost respect. No business activity other than safety on the job is more important than helping a customer. Okay? And everybody knew that. The second thing was the moral, social, and business obligation to make a profit. If we don't make a profit, we can't hire more people. We can't expand. We can't invent new products. We can't take care of our customers. We can't do anything. So we had to make a profit. The third thing was a positive attitude and a sense of urgency. How we can today. Not why we can't and not do it tomorrow. How we can today. Great lesson in life. The fourth was the absolute belief that the performance and productivity of each of us can be better. There's not one of us in this room that is currently performing at the peak of our ability. We can, in fact, do more. And so, as I said earlier, the idea was to create an environment where people would be self-motivated to overachieve. The fifth was the importance of planning. There's an old saying, the person who fails to plan, plans to fail. A lot of companies write business plans and used to put them on the shelf. Now they just leave them in the computer. But they write an annual business plan and never look at it again. Well, they'll do a five-year strategic plan and never revisit it. But we said planning is a lot more than those. It's every day. It's every sales call. It's every laboratory experiment that we'll be doing today. Plan. And then the last was that we will always operate in a safe, professional, ethical, and legal manner with the highest regard for the people with whom we're interacting. I used to talk to our group, and we called ourselves associates instead of employees. You know, a lot of people do that, but we really believed that we were all associated. We all drank the Kool-Aid. I used to say, the fastest way to become a former Steris associate is to lie, cheat, or steal. Okay? We will not do that. We will operate in a safe, professional, ethical, and legal manner with the highest regard for the people with whom we're interacting. I have run out of time, and so I'm not going to brag about a bunch of other stuff that is really important, but I am going to encourage you very strongly to be involved with your community. And your community is wherever you are, okay? Because we are all one big community, but it's critically important for you to share your talents and time doing things that are worthwhile. So to summarize, again, primarily for you students in the audience, you are living in a great place, Northeast Ohio. We had a little dinky company, as was said in the introduction, that started with five people and now have, I think the number's up to 5,500. Just a tremendous, tremendous company. And it was done here, something that had never been done anywhere else in the world to invent this original system. You're at Lakeland Community College. It's not only a fine educational institution, but it's a heck of a bargain compared to what's out there at this point in time. You have all kinds of opportunities, but it's up to you to have a commitment, to work your tails off, to be persistent, to never give up. And if I can indulge to share two of my favorite sayings to close, the first is that it's okay to try and not succeed, but it's not okay not to try. And the second is that you can get anything you want in life if you help enough other people get what they want. And that's the customer approach. Everyone with whom we're dealing is a customer who has a need, and we have to try to help them fulfill that need. If we do that, they'll be happy, and we can get what we want. So with that, I will end and wish all of you, for the last time, I'll say especially you students, my sincere best wishes for your great success. And it's up to you. It's not up to anybody else. It's up to you. So, Q&A. My political comments are that I hate the way our system works. But beyond that, this is an incredibly important election, and I don't want to be partisan at all. But now we're living in the greatest company, greatest country in the world, far and away. With all of our warts and cuts and bruises, we are really, really, really good. And we need to be proud of what we're doing and not drag it down on both sides. Secondly, the personal attacks have no place here. We should be dealing with ideas. But the third, and this will perhaps be the most politically controversial, but I am a huge private sector person. I think that the government works for us and not the other way around. And I have to share with you an observation. I'm on the boards of directors of 9 or 10 companies. And I say 9 or 10 because I think I just got off one, but I'm not sure, because we're selling the company, so I'm hopeful. But in any case, they range in size from what Steris was in 1987, little tiny companies just getting a technology out of a laboratory at a university, to major New York Stock Exchange listed companies with $85 billion in assets, okay? Everything in between. And I will say categorically, directly, whatever the right word is, Jim Collins, absolutely, in the last 2 years, at every board meeting I've been in any size company, in any industry, in any environment, the number one topic of discussion is government regulation and the adversarial relationship between the government and the private sector. When the FDA, EPA, DOJ, SEC, OSHA, when those people show up at your doorstep in a business, you are guilty until proven innocent. And it is wrong. It is absolutely wrong. We're in a globally competitive environment. We being the government and the private sector should be working together for the common good. If we want to compete globally, if we want to create jobs, if we want to have the best trade relations, if we want to be the most inventive, then we should be figuring out how we can rather than why we cannot. It's just craziness, okay? And so I hope when you go out and vote, you really think about this thing you're marking or the lever you're pulling, because it makes a difference. And again, that's not a partisan thing. It is knowing the individuals, knowing what they stand for, knowing what they, and you can believe about half of it, what they say they're going to do. But in any case, don't promote having the government and the private sector fight with one another. The government does not create jobs other than the hiring jobs in this environment. But the real jobs are created by a dynamic private sector. We talk about taxes and raising taxes, reducing taxes. That's a stupid argument, because we need to have globally competitive tax rates, okay? And so I am a big proponent of reducing tax rates. I am an absolute proponent of increasing tax revenues. And you do that by creating an environment, because of the lower taxes, that encourages entrepreneurship, it encourages private sector investing, it encourages growth, and believe it or not, when more people go to work in meaningful jobs, not make work jobs, in meaningful jobs, they make a nice living, and guess what they do? They pay taxes. And the more people you have paying taxes in a vibrant economy, the more tax revenues you get for the government to spend. So it's so economically and logically simple, and it just drives me nuts that we choose to fight each other instead of saying how we can be more effective. So, sorry for the diatribe. Oh no, they're all over the world. And I'll say it again, we're in a global economy. You know, we can harp all day about China stealing our jobs and what have you, and they have unfair trade practices. We have unfair trade practices. We all do, okay? We're in competition, for goodness sake. The best thing that we can do as a country is to be the most inventive, the fastest to market. We're destroying our medical device sector. It is not with, there's no question that the medical device and pharmaceutical industries are the greatest in the world and have traditionally been the most productive in the world. Right now, because of a lot of government actions only, with the FDA and other sorts of regulations, we're moving stuff out of the country because we can't get it approved here. It's not because anybody wants to, it's because it just doesn't work. Okay? So back to the, I'm sorry, I sound like a politician up here, never answering the question. My guesstimate, and I'm not involved with Steris anymore at all, but my guesstimate is probably two-thirds or so are in the U.S., but they have operations all over the world, which is important. Even back in my days, we had operations in 60 countries. Well, actually, Steris was here, Ray Kralovic, the scientist, was here, and the investment was here, and so I was just spending a lot of time, and I became intrigued with Cleveland, and it's not that far from Columbus, even though some people in Columbus think it is, but and that's a great place. We're really fortunate here. I say we. I live in Florida now, and I'm really fortunate, but you know, we all know about the great educational institutions and the arts and the wonderful history and Lake Erie and beautiful falls, lousy Februarys, but it's a terrific place. My personal motivation when I got started, it was a family motivation. It was my mother more than anything else. She just always believed that you, if you're going to do something, do it the best you can. And so I've got I won't go on beyond that. But it was, and also to serve others. You know, this idea is everybody's a customer, and if you help enough other people, you can get anything you want. I mean, I really believe that. And one of the great things about being in the healthcare industry is that we really do help people. I mean, this thing that was invented here in Ohio, it's called Steris System 1, was the first ever way to rapidly sterilize heat-sensitive surgical and diagnostic devices. And all of you have heard of laparoscopic surgery and arthroscopies and these sorts of things. Well, at the time that we invented that thing, Ray Kralovic and the whole team invented the thing, nothing existed. And so we really facilitated the rapid advance of minimally invasive procedures like colonoscopies and arthroscopies and all of those sorts of things. And so it is an absolute motivation when you get letters from people thanking you for having a device that helped them. And another thing, another motivating factor, I used to get letters from shareholders with pictures of the additions to their homes that they paid with the money they made on Steris stock, or the kid graduating, having his or her diploma from Lakeland and from Ohio State, saying, we paid for it with the money we made on Steris stock. And that's motivating. Several, although I will throw out a disclaimer, I am a sucker for everything. I mean, I love stuff, okay? And I have this distorted ego that makes me think that we can make everything work, and it's not the case. But to directly answer the question, the answer comes really from some of my early experiences with other venture capitalists. And one said, when I look at investing in a company, there are only five things that I look at. Number one, management. Number two, management. Number three, management. Number four, market, and number five, product, service, technology, you know, whatever it is. And then he followed on by saying, give me an A management team with a C product, and I'll kick the ass of a C management team with an A product. Okay? And that's really true. I think one has to truly look at the people who are going to be leading the parade. Do they have the desire, the capability, the understanding of the marketplace, the commitment to customers, all of those sorts of things, and the leadership qualities that will rally a team to be successful. But then market is next. I fully agree with that. And last is the product, service, technology. So, but it's got to be pretty good too. Yes. I have had so many that I should be the smartest guy in town. One of my early failures was I mentioned that we were doing expert systems on little tiny lousy computers years ago. I mean, these things were really, really, really good. But in order for a physician or a hospital or someone to want to use them, there had to be reimbursement. And our government chose not to reimburse for the use of an expert system because it was not the independent judgment of a physician, as an example. And so that product line failed, not because of what it did. In fact, they're being used now, the same things that we created years ago, but it was because the people didn't get paid to use them. So you can have, that's an unintended consequence. Others were not following the guidelines about the management team first. Every failure that I've been involved with where I was not directly, and a lot of failures are my fault, but where I was not directly involved has been having selected the wrong leader for the organization. Billions billions both with a B and plural, a lot. Jim, I, as I said earlier, I'm not directly associated, but I can give you some stories from back in the late 90s about the economic value. One year, for example, when we were really in our growth phase, we were transferring people into Lake County quite a lot, from, you know, promoting them from the field sales force and all that sort of things. And in the first 9 months of, I think, 96 or something like that, because I did these numbers, in the first 9 months, they bought $35 million worth of homes in Lake County. And think about, you know, the lawn mowing services and babysitting and cars from Classic, from Jim Brown, and haircuts, and I mean, all that kind of stuff. Another important statistic is that we tried, and I think they still do, we tried to buy locally as much as we could because of wonderful machine shops and things like that that can support industry. And so we were buying at one point over 75% of all of our goods and services from within 50 miles of our corporate facility here. And those are just enormous economic values. The tax rates, hundreds, not tens, hundreds of millions of dollars in taxes paid through payroll taxes and property taxes and those kinds of things over a period of time. So of those 5,000 people, I think something like 1,500 of them live right here, and then another couple of thousand in other parts of the United States, and then the rest outside the country would be my guess. But it's just an enormous value. There's also a tremendous value of being the corporate headquarters city, because our global revenues, those who can come in without the stupid taxation that is assessed, but assuming that global revenues come in, they're consolidated here. I mean, this is where all the action is. So this is where the money goes. And so a lot more on a proportional basis would be spent here than somewhere else. philanthropy. I know Steris have done a lot for Lakeland Community College in equipping the health technology centers and those scholarships and other sorts of things. So big value. That's exactly right. I'd call home and say, hey, guess where we're going to live next week? Now, that was a different time, though. Those of you who are old enough to remember, IBM used to stand for I've Been Moved. Okay, and you know, they did that. That was just part of the overall corporate development program. And so, I got the crap jobs because I was pretty good at fixing things. You know, identify and doing it fast. You know, how we can today. I had that philosophy a long time ago. I'm going to get back to finish answer that. But here's another really great saying for companies in particular, big companies. Act small to grow big. Okay? Act small to grow big. Every customer is important. Now, where did I get my business acumen or whatever the right word is? You know, farmers are pretty darn self-sufficient. And farmers are probably the most entrepreneurial people you'll ever meet because they have to be. You know, they're taking care of the old family farmer. No, today's corporate farm, different story. Okay. But it was an upbringing thing. And I could do numbers. We talked about that earlier today. I counted to 100 the first day of school. So numbers didn't bother me. I loved science, and I understood healthcare and all that kind of stuff. But I think most importantly, I had the ability to really understand what would motivate a customer. So I think you've got to be tired of listening to this old guy babble on. And so thank you very much for being here.